Now we have set the stage, thanks to Rand, and now we're going to bring up a panel, and we're going to talk about some how do we enhance the golfer experience. We've got some wise people from different backgrounds in the golf business, and Hunky Yun is going to be the man who moderates it. Hunky, come on up, joined by Parker Anderson, Bruce Charlton, Lauren Johnson, Arthur Little, and Andy Tiger.
Good luck.
Bruce, right here, the red button right there.
Red button?
Yeah.
Are we live now?
Yeah.
Good. Perfect.
Thank you, Bob. I really appreciate it. And thank you for all the work you've done to facilitate things. So my name is Hunky Yun. I'm the Director of Outreach, Partnerships, and Education for one of the newest departments at the USGA called Research, Science, and Innovation. I think the name is pretty self-explanatory. And I think my story at the USGA illustrates a little bit of what we're doing here and what the focus of the USGA and how it's changed over the years. I started the USGA about 5.5 years ago. I have a background in journalism, worked for magazines, Golf Digest, Golf Magazine, et cetera. And when I started the USGA, I worked in the communications department. And much of my focus was working at championship, publicizing the results and the stories of our championships, our players, and it's the most highly visible and probably the most impactful mission that the USGA has been doing since its founding in 1894. But 4 years ago, in 2013, I had the opportunity to work on our Pace of Play initiative. It was a little bit of a change. And I don't know if you remember, the Pace of Play initiative was founded with a series of PSAs called While We're Young, named by Clint Eastwood, Annika Sorensen, very funny, very interesting, and they were very compelling. And I think if it was 20, 30 years ago, the PSAs, the awareness, the promotion would have been all that the USGA did to bring awareness to an issue in golf that impacted a lot of people. But we are moving beyond that to actually look for research, look at data, look at solutions, bring people like our panel together in a room in order to discuss how we can actually improve the experience, not just make people aware about it. Awareness is the first part, actually doing something is the second part. And we're right in the middle of it. And this evolution of my work at the USGA, I'm very proud of, and it's actually reflective of everything we're doing at the USGA, and it's for golfers and for facilities, the way Rand and Mike had mentioned. So I just wanted to book that as intro, and as we move forward this presentation, I'll invite all of these experts to talk a little bit about some of the work we're doing, some of the projects, some of the research, some of the data collection that we've been doing. So I'll introduce them in turn as they come up. But we're first going to start with a little presentation, a little preamble of what we're doing here. So since we're in Canada, it's going to be a little pandering. Anybody recognize the woman on the screen here? This is the only time you can actually say something without going through the app. Anybody recognize her? Judith, yes, Judith. Judith is she's a very good golfer, but she's one of 30 million golfers in the US, Canada, and Mexico. And like all the other golfers, there's a lot of things that facility managers can do to improve her experience. So we're going to go through some of these factors. We'll go through some of these factors in the next discussion, the panel discussion, about that we have some practitioners in the room to talk about how they feel like they impact the golfer experience. But you know, some of the things that impact her experience is how well she plays. And some of that is determined by the course design, some of it is designed by setup, some of it is designed by how she's feeling that way. I mean, and so skill level for a beginner, how well she plays can be determined by how many times she gets the ball in the air. For someone like Judith, it's probably whether she can shoot 65 or 66. Who she plays with. Golf is a social game, and you're spending 4 or 5 hours, hopefully not 6 hours, with people out on the golf course. And you better like the first people you're working with. And I think that for many of you, the best, some of the most memorable rounds, some of the most memorable experiences you've had are because of some of the people that you've played with. Where she plays. This is we've actually used this as a kind of our title screen. This is Capilano Golf Club, right across a few miles from here. Beautiful place and with some incredible views. And I think today we have a decent day, so you have some views similar to this. And certainly our Bruce Charlton, course designer here. So the some of the aesthetics and some of the things that you put into some of the features influences your experience with a golf course. How should you treat it? Customer service. Certainly, you're going to a place of business. You interact with the employees, and you want to be treated well, and you want to have a good experience there. conditioning the off course. There's a reason that half of course facility budgets go to maintaining a golf course, because it is the playing conditions are probably, and our surveys and any other survey shows, it's the most important factor in the golfer experience. The length of the holes. So when in any sort of sport or any experience, I think the proportion of the playing grounds probably needs to meet the skill level or the expectation of the golfer. You wouldn't expect the hockey to be played on a football field. It just wouldn't be the same experience. It needs to fit perfectly, and we're here to talk about a lot of that here. And then finally, pace of play. Time, anything is part of the experience, whether you're talking about going to a restaurant, whether you're talking about going to an amusement park, whether you're talking about a commute, time is a huge part of the experience, and people continually say the pace of play, the delays, the waits are a big part of the experience. So these last two things are what we're gonna talk about. And with all these make up a day at the golf course, and we're gonna talk about some of the ways the facilities can improve that experience. And the first thing we're gonna start with is course design and setup. And to talk about a little bit about this to set the stage, I'd like to introduce you to Bruce Charlton. But before we do that, I'm sorry, I got a little ahead of myself. Sorry about that, Bruce, type for a sec. I wanted to introduce you to some research that we have done. Rand referenced the tracker, the programmatic survey that we've done. And since we launched Tee It Forward in 2011, we've asked some questions about how people thought about Tee It Forward. Tee It Forward was a program that we launched with the PGA of America. And it basically, at the time, it encouraged golfers to move up a set of tees or move up to a set of tees that was more appropriate to their skill level. It was very successful at first, and it's kind of been, over the last few years, it's just kind of been a part of the natural conversation, but we haven't done much to try to promote it or try to help facilities to build sets of tees or to provide guidance or research that provide better guidance for facilities. But when we actually asked golfers to try Tee It Forward, what their opinion was, these are about 2,500 golfers, did it have a positive impact in enjoying the round? The response was nearly unanimous. 93% said it had a positive impact. And then we asked them another question. This was part of a series of questions that we asked. And we asked them, you know, at the course you play, do you hit the ball far enough to reach the two or three shot holes in regulation? All golfers, only 43% have said they don't hit the ball far enough. So only, you know, and then for women, more than half don't hit the ball, which is, to me, it's an interesting way to play a golf course if you can't hit the ball in regulation. So Bruce will talk a little bit more about that. And then finally, we asked golfers, should you be assigned a particular tee box at the start, by the starter or whoever, based on your handicap, average score, distance? Golfers said, yeah. Half of them said, yeah, I think that golfers should. When we asked facilities the same question, only 20%, less than 20% said they should. So this is one of the disconnects we found between what golfers value, what the golfers think it should be experienced, and what facilities think golfers value. And during the next discussion, we'll talk a few more about these things, but this is some of the things that drive our discussion, some of the ways that we build our products, build our programs, and build our communication. Now we're gonna bring up Bruce. Bruce Charlton, he is president of RTJ II. And he is, as of right now, this sitting, this is Chambers Bay, hosted the 2015 US Open, which he co-designed. He is one of only two living people to have designed a US Open golf course. That's gonna change this year after Aaron Hills, but he is definitely one of the leading practitioners in his trade, former president of the ASGCA. And when he goes and designs a golf course, he basically takes a lot of care and thought into design. These are the plans for the 12th, 13th, and 14th holes for Chambers Bay. And then when he designs a golf course, he takes a lot of care in like green complexes, look at the detail that he has. And I'd love Bruce to come out and talk a little bit about the thought process that he goes into designing a golf course, and then into tees and where how golf courses fit different levels of golfers.
Well, I think, you know, one of the things that we always focus on in golf course design is how the game's gonna be played and who's playing it. And from not only distance, but angle is extremely important. And one of the things that in this slide, what we incorporated at Chambers Bay was width, and more width to allow people to, you know, really have a chance to get it in the middle of the fairway or get it to the side of the fairway. And then almost all of the greens in this case were designed to have the ability to run a shot on the ground into that green complex. And this plan here on your right, the little green sketch there, shows almost everything peripherally, with the angles of plays, with the big arrows coming in from the sides. So this is some of the things that, from a golf course architecture perspective, you're always trying to think about what's the maximum way you can allow players to access the greens. And a lot of golf courses that have been built over time produce an aerial style game. And one of the things we're trying to do, and I think all the golf architects in the room with these crazy red jackets on, would stress the fact that they're really trying to make the golf greens especially, much more accessible by hitting the ball on the ground and using slopes and doing that kind of thing.
So we're focusing on greens here. What is your thought process when it comes to placing tees? How many tees, where to place them, and such?
Well, you know, it's all related, again, to the type of facility that you're asked to design. Believe it or not, the owners play a huge role in the way you go about designing a golf course. But I tell you, one of the things that we like to do, and I think the industry is really starting to grab onto, is give the golf course as much flexibility as you possibly can. And having teeing grounds that not necessarily are typical teeing grounds, but give you all kinds of length. I mean, Robert Trent Jones Sr. years ago, you know, he did these long runway tees with the concept of letting the players move up and down these tees according to their skill level. You know, he was right on some ideas. So I think that the amount of tees, the number of tees, where people are teeing from, really relates mostly to your market and who's going to be playing the golf course. That's the key component,
great.
I think.
Okay. When Bruce mentioned owners, Arthur gave a chuckle because he is the former owner of Province Lake Golf Club in right on the New Hampshire Maine border. So obviously has a lot of experience with that. He's also one of the foremost proponents of experience, and especially with the tee placements and tees for all levels of players, especially women. So before Arthur will talk a little bit about some of the, in addition to these, he has commissioned a lot of research to help facilities, to help the golf industry better understand how different levels of players play the golf course. And we want to talk to him, but before he talks a little bit about that, I wanted to ask you, you know, based on some of the data that Rand said and what some of the chuckles you've had, what compelled you to buy a golf course?
Loss of sanity. Now, my wife and I actually, the golf course was right near our home in New Hampshire. I wish I'd put the aerial picture in, just in a lovely location, basically good bones. Former owner just let it run downhill, and we foolishly thought we could bring it back overnight. Okay, wrong. But in any case, after we bought the golf course and observed our players, and we had quite a few women, a lot of senior men, hardly any juniors. And we just concluded that the way the golf course was set up was, frankly, way too long for many of our players to be able to reach greens in regulation. So we completely rebuilt the teeing system. It's a little hard to read this sign, unfortunately, but if you look at the player's ability, the first thing that we put in terms of what your tee selection should be is how far you hit your drive, because we think that is the critical point. We also did the handicaps because some people want to look at it. And I will tell you that the result of this was that we really created a course at 4162, it is now, that women could play very comfortably, juniors could play very comfortably, and our senior men moved from what used to be, you know, moved to what used to be, quote, the women's tees. So all of that had an incredibly positive result. If I could just make one note, I hope all of you looked very carefully at the visual before Mike Davis's speech. Very important to see women, kids, besides men. Many of these kinds of things, all you're going to see is men. It is critical for the golf course industry to understand that it has to be directed toward attracting families. Okay.
Okay.
End of that sermon.
Okay, end of that sermon. So, Arthur, after your experience at Province Lake, would it be fair to call you an evangelist of sorts?
I've been at this now for almost 20 years. The sign that you just saw dates from either 1998 or 1999. I can't quite remember which. But we concluded, I mean, here my wife and I, this little course out in the middle of nowhere in northern New England, and we thought we really were onto an idea here, but we really needed some professional research to back it up. Because we're thinking, who the hell is going to pay attention to, these podunk people from wherever. So anyhow, we asked a gentleman by the name of Gene Parenti, who owns and runs Golf Laboratories near San Diego, to do the test that you see down on the bottom on the protocol. We went from 55, which was average woman's swing speed is 65. We went to 55 because we wanted to go for juniors and that. We went up to 125 because we then covered the full range of a full spectrum of people up into including the pros. And the key things here for us, and you'll just get a peek at this data in a minute, is we wanted to understand both, this way across the swing speeds and through the entire bag, how those numbers related to one another.
So this is an interest of time. We won't go through every swing speed in 10 millimeters, but we'll start with the typical tour pro level
here's
swing
your,
speed.
Yeah, player. Here's yeah. your typical tour pro. Okay. Actual speed last year, average 113.9. So, and what we were really interested in, what you're looking at here is the total distance. We had both carry distance and total distance measured. All of the, you could look at all these charts. I have all of them. If any of you want all the data, give me your card. I've already tortured the entire membership of ASGCA with them. But just let me know. I'd be happy to send it to you.
Okay. We'll move forward to kind of an 85 mile per hour, which is a little less than your average man, right?
Yeah, this is a little less. The average man is in the 89, 90 area. And so that was kind of, representative of that group. And then do we have one more, Hunky?
We have one more, 55.
And then 55. Now this, and this will tie in to what Bruce tells you later about the longleaf tee system. And because this really is the player who's hitting the ball, carrying it 100 yards and getting a total, as you see on that slide. So again, really trying to look at the whole spectrum of golfers.
So looking at this, you used robot testing for this.
Right.
So what are some of the differences between robots and actual human data?
Well,
human hitting,
we
people
had,
actually hitting
we data. Had a little conversation. The answer is that the human data is worse. we had a little conversation this morning about that, and one of the things that I'm going to prompt the USGA to do is to try to get a little bit more accurate testing on normal people. What we did ask Gene to do, well, I'm not sure the golfers are normal, but anyhow, what we did ask Gene to do was to screw up his machine settings so that it would become inefficient. And what we found from those data was that essentially at all swing speeds, there was about a 10% decrease in terms of carry and total yardage. I think it's actually worse than that, but anyhow.
Okay, so now this is how we're using the data, correct?
Right. This is a slide that the USGA did. I worked with them a little bit. I gave them some input on this. If you take this slide and you compare it to the data that any of you want to get, you will find that they are so close to one another that there is not a statistical significant leap, excuse me, as a, difference in them. This is very good. Obviously, we need to do this for par threes and par fives. Again, it's all math.
Okay, so this is a guide that the USGA is working with Arthur to try to develop as guidance, as a guide to make available to facilities, to architects, and I know the ASGCA has their own system that we're working, but what it shows to me, it shows is how remarkably short the tees that are at the forward tees must be in order to have the same sort of challenges. So as Bruce, as an architect, when you look at this sort of information, what do you glean from it? And how is this going to help you and other architects to when you design or redesign golf courses?
Well, you know, it's all about fun. I think you need to get players into a position off the tee where they have a chance to succeed and have fun. And so what this is telling me is that, you know, you need to think a lot further forward than the norm. Mm-hmm. And we'll talk a little bit about
that. Yeah, sure. If I could just add, you'll see some scorecards in a minute. Almost everybody that I talk to who hasn't thought about this is totally shocked by how far forward the forward tees exactly. need to be.
So Bruce, I didn't ask you this before, but when you looked at that stat about 51% of women, 43% of men mm-hmm. don't hit the ball they don't hit the ball far enough to to reach greens and regulars. Is that something that's surprising to you?
No. I don't think so. We find, for I don't know whatever reasons, but we find people playing exactly the wrong tees that they should be. I mean, I've got a group of my high school golf team buddies, and we go on a trip every fall, and it's like, where are we going to play from? Oh, we got to play it from the backs because we got to take the whole thing on. And I'm going, no, not me anymore, guys. I design these things for a living. I'm playing two tees up. Yeah. So, I mean, it's just getting people to understand their skill level. I think that's the key thing.
Okay.
Yeah. And then I think one other quick point that I would make: the tee at forward thing was absolutely terrific
fantastic.
For men. Where were the women going to tee it forward to?
Good point. Two,
those tees didn't exist.
Okay. So Arthur, you've worked with a lot of architects, and you've kind of influenced their thinking with TFS. So here's a couple of examples that you have in real world case studies.
Yeah, this is Mike Kaiser's new course at Sand Valley. This was done by Bill Coore. In this case, my only responsibility was for the placement of the Royal Blue, the most forward tees. You'll notice here we're actually under 4,000 yards. There are a couple of really uphill shots on this course, actually about five really uphill shots. A lot harder for slower swing speed players. I did, however, do a preliminary work to give at least kind of my guidance as to where the other tees might be. If I produced that document for you here, you'd see that the Kaisers came out really pretty close to what I suggested relative to the other tee lines.
Okay. Another one? This is a redesign, right?
Now, I'm sorry the numbers are so small here. This is, with the exception of a little bit of what you're going to hear later from Bruce, this is absolutely nirvana. Okay, this is Andy Staples was asked by the people at Meadowbrook Country Club, which is a little northwest of Detroit, to really redo their course. You will see that the forward tees are a little over 4,000 yards and the back tees are a little over 7,000. But with the combo courses that you can see there, there are literally 10 different yardages that you can play on this course. I would strongly suggest that 95% of golfers ought to be able to find a set of tees that they can play comfortably here.
So Arthur, on that scorecard, you've got little triangles or arrows.
Right.
So if you want to play a combo between the red and the black, you just follow those arrows,
you just follow
right?
the arrows.
Okay.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that's fun.
As reference, I believe this, the front and back of the scorecard is available as a handout on the apps for those who want to study it. So, and then, moving on the same vein, Bruce is going to talk about the longleaf system, which is a partnership between the ASGCA Foundation and U.S. Kids Golf.
Yeah, Hunky, I want to correct you on one thing.
Okay.
Well, not correct you, but
just
say how excited I am. You mentioned that there's only two people alive. Well, that's going to change.
Yes,
in June. Yes. In June, and I can't wait. You know, my good friends, Mike Hertz and Dana Fry, Ron Witten, you know, they all had huge roles in Erin Hills, and
sure.
and I can't wait for the best players in the world to play that golf course. It's going to be a lot of fun. So, secondly, I'm here mostly as a member of the American Society of Golf Course Architects. This is a program that the ASGCA Foundation, which I'm secretary treasurer of right now, is something that the foundation is kind of an arm of the American Society of Golf Course Architects to promote the future of golf course architecture and really try to help strengthen the growth and health of the game of golf. That's kind of our mission statement, if you will. So knowing that, the folks at US Kids Golf, Dan Van Horn, came to us with this idea that he's had in place and he's really trying to promote in Pinehurst, North Carolina. And you know, US Kids does unbelievable work with kids. Not only do they provide equipment, but they have, I don't know how many tournaments around the world. And they have just seen through all their setups of these tournaments how lacking golf course facilities are to really take advantage of providing a fun golf experience based on your skill level. So what the heck do? They come to us as the architects and they say, guys, I think you guys are the ones that probably are the best people to talk about this and get everybody excited about it and talk about how you implement it. So we were delighted at our meeting in Washington, D.C. last year. We went, yeah, okay, let's do this. So the key concept of this whole longleaf tee system, which is named after the Longleaf family and golf club in Pinehurst, where Dan Van Horn actually put his money where his mouth is and bought the place and is operating it for a family golf course, so to speak. But the key thing is that fun is derived when everybody teeing it up that day has a chance to score par, to shoot par. That's success. So when you take that as your baseline, whoa, things get to be very, very interesting. And so one of these offshoots of this whole idea is, you know, more fun, better pace of play. And as I'm gonna explain, this whole system is based on metrics of how far you carry the ball off the tee. And it's based on simple math. And so go ahead, next slide there, Hunky, I think. So what we did, this whole thing began in Pinehurst. Basically just to kind of let you know, this has all happened within the last year. So it's in its infant stage, and we're really just rolling it out right now. Aileen Smith from the ASGCA is here. She's in the back. Aileen. She gave me a pamphlet, which I immediately left on my table over there. But there's a pamphlet that we've provided. You can get that, and it's going to be up on our website soon. The whole aspect of this, www.asgca.org. Now I got that done. But anyhow, it's something that as architects, we're extremely excited about, because not only do we see the ability of the players to really enjoy the golf courses we lay out, but also we see the ability to retrofit all kinds of courses. We frankly see it as a way that our members of our society can generate more work by helping courses look at these options. So that's kind of one of the big picture ideas here. Correct. Okay, next slide. It'll be good. So how it works. It's very, very simple, and it's based on how far do I hit the ball off the tee. And we know that every course is different, and this is not a cookie cutter formula type of system, but we want people to come to the golf course and go, hey, which tee is right for me? I was telling the story about my high school golf team buddies. Well, the thing to do is, on the slide on the right-hand side of this picture, is go to the range, hit about 20 balls, and gauge how far your ball flies in the air and where it lands. And I guarantee you, I don't know, when I did it and some of the people around me did it, we were amazed how not very far we hit the ball off the tee. In fact, it made me feel kind of old. But so what it did though, and in this case, this is longleaf, they color coded the poles out in the range, and basically, you just watch where your balls landed and say, you know, there's a black pole way back there. I didn't come anywhere close to that. I was between like 4 and 5, the orange and white. So that's how you determine what tee you go to based on the total carry of the golf ball. And then the course allows itself. Next slide, we'll kind of show you how the golf course lays out. So what this shows is, and I think it's very, very important that this graphic, there's a tee that's not even on here. There's a tee that's, I don't know if you can see it, but there's a tee that's back behind this red tee called the black tee, and that's 7,400 yards from that tee. But here's the idea, is based on how far you hit the ball, you move your landing area up to that location so that everybody has a chance to get on this green in regulation with approximately the same club. So it's just a matter of distance and how far you carry the ball. And one of the things that this slide does a good job of is, and I'm a real strong believer in this, and especially on some courses that have more terrain, it's not only distance. As you can see, these tees are moving in their angle based on the type of slightly left or right dogleg hole and diagonal. So, you know, those are the kind of things you need to look at. One of the things about this slide, you see the two most forward tees are actually in the fairway. We believe that that's a wonderful concept. In fact, we could even add fairways, I mean, add tees right at the next to the edge of the fairway and have cutouts and make them all part of the fairway. So this is a concept that's extremely easy, actually, to implement. Now, one of the things to keep in mind on some of your courses, a lot of courses were built recently, have 5 tees, 6 tees, 4 tees, and they're in pods. Don't lose sight of the fact that you can put, you know, more than one tee block on a tee. You know, there are many cases where, you know, say for in this example, the purple and white tee could be on the same tee area, teeing ground. I think Bill Bergen was the ASGCA member that did this, and he actually constructed, I think it was 23 or 24 new tees on this facility, and then utilized all the other tees that they had. So it's a fairly easy thing to implement. But key thing is get everybody to that part in the fairway where they feel like they can get the ball in the green in two, and then on a par four, par five, it's a par, you know, three shots. So it's get it in regulation and then go have fun.
Yeah, and you already mentioned hilliness, which makes a big difference. Yeah. The other two main things really are what's the turf type and how many cross hazards do you have to negotiate?
Yeah. Well, and the cross hazards concept, you know, was something that was very popular in older architecture. I love it. But to me, you got to give people a place to maneuver around that and bailout zones or whatever you want to call it. So, a little bit more on this tee, so it may be kind of hard to read, but bottom line is that the long leaf tee system starts at 3,200 yards and basically goes back in 600-yard increments. So you go from 32 to 38, you know, if you can do the math, which I'm a little weak on. But anyhow, everything ends up playing to that total distance. And you know, it's up to us from a golf course design perspective to analyze this whole tee system on an existing course. On a new course, it's piece of cake. We can put this kind of stuff in all over the place. But you don't necessarily have to say, there's 8 tees shown here, right? So you don't necessarily have to have 8 tee blocks. I'm a huge fan of these forward tees. Some of the most forward ones are right spots in fairway. And there's a lot of fairways out there. If you're really creative and look at them, there's great spots for these forward tees. One of the things I think that's really important to this is eliminate wasted or irrelevant shots. If you're not playing from the direct tee, you hit a tee shot, and there's no way you're getting to the green in two, or there's no on a par four. So your next shot is kind of, you know, a wasted shot. So by moving people up based on their skill level, every shot now becomes much more relevant. It keeps your attention in the game. It's a heck of a lot more fun. And I think, and it's proven at Longleaf, that you know more fun means more rounds. And the people just keep coming. So here's how we're working it. I mean, Reese and Steve and Greg are working on this right now at Medina number 2, and great concept. And one of the things, folks, you don't have to call this the Long Leaf Tea Initiative. I was talking to Reese recently, and you know, they're working on all kinds of different names to call it at Medina. But it's basically just providing the tea system, however you want to name it. Down at Sugar Creek in Texas, Jeff Bloom, great member of our organization, is working on it. And then Bill Bergen was the guy that did it at Long Leaf and is kind of our champion spokesman for this of the ASGCA. And I just got back from Argentina, and I had all the documents and everything. We're building a brand new course there. And I explained this whole tee system, and they looked at me like deer in the headlights. They thought I was crazy. But one of the things we're doing there, much like Chambers Bay, is that the fairway is the tee is the fairway. So you just roll out from the start of the hole right into the fairway, and it's so easy to implement that on that kind of a tee system. And then we change angles with the way the tee's meandering and stuff like that. But anyhow, there's ways to do this, and I encourage you to really study your golf course and the golf courses that you're managing or whatever and say, how do I look at this with a brand new perspective? And really base it on how people's skill levels are. It's just that simple.
Great. And let me add two points. One was in the points in the slides that you had. Absolutely, get rid of any words that talk about either age or gender. The golf ball does not care who the hell's hitting it. Second thing, as I mentioned, I've been working on this idea about shorter tees for a long time. We are so enthusiastic, our family is so enthusiastic about what the ASGCA is doing, that I am going to present Eileen a little bit later today with a pledge of $75,000 that our family foundation is giving to help promote this and then do some further education work on it and research.
Yes.
Thank you, Arthur, and it's wonderful news, and thank you, Bruce. So moving on to our day at the golf course. So we have the grounds on which we have built our golf course. And hopefully we have the tees, we have the holes that promote smooth flow. And when we look at pace of play, we back to the research that we are doing, I have done. Could you move forward one, please? Thank you. So with pace of play, it's always viewed as one of the most important issues with golfer experience. And when we asked golfers, almost 3/4 of them said it was very important to their enjoyment of the round. And half of them thought that the pace of play could be improved at their course. We asked facilities the same question. What do you think golfers value? And they have similar views about pace of play. And they believe it's a big problem in golf, nearly 2/3. But they see it as a problem on a global scale, not a local one. The same people said, only 12% of them said it's a slow play as a problem at their facility. So there's a bit of a disconnect between what they think as a problem in golf and a problem as a facility. So basically, it's a problem somewhere else, not at their facility. And if you're not willing to take a look at pace play as a problem at your facility, you're not going to take steps to change it. So a lot of facilities take a look at golfers as the problem. Say we don't really have a problem, but it's the golfers when they need to move it along. But we believe the facilities do have their part to play, and we want to try to help them. And one of the biggest ways that we can help them is with tee time intervals. I know that it's a huge issue for a lot of people. People see tee time intervals as the primary way of measuring inventory and thus revenue. But tee time intervals also do have a huge factor in pace of play and golfer experience. It's a way of weighing one or the other. It doesn't have to be one or the occasion. We'll show over the next 20 minutes or so that it's actually a way to increase or to maximize their revenue based on some of the data that we've done. So to talk about tee time intervals, we bring up Lauren Johnson, who's a data analyst, and we went to Rancho Park Golf Course in LA. It's the only public course, municipal course, for miles around. And we want to actually credit or recognize Global Golf Advisors, Henry Delosier and Derek Johnson in the room. They did a huge strategic report for the city. And one of the things they issued was pace of play, which helped in the messaging and the research that we did with pace of play. So to set the background, Rancho Park does 100,000 rounds a year. They start teeing off at 5 in the morning before sunrise. We went there, and it's unbelievable. You go, and people are waiting. They open the gates at 4:30. People are actually waiting to get into the golf course, and then they're teeing off before dark. I'm not sure how they find their balls. They must be really good players. But at the time, they had 6-minute tee time intervals, which we'll kind of look at. And Lauren's going to go through what we found as far as when we started collecting research and data about pace of play at Rancho Park.
So first, I want to go through what we actually did with the data collection. So here you see the golf course. This is actually Rancho Park. And what we did was we went and set up at the first tee box and asked golfers to keep this little GPS logger in their pockets while they played. It's really light, it's like a flash drive. Kind of forget it's there. But what it does is it enables us to collect where they're going on the course and also how long it's taking them at each hole. We see which hole kind of causes a backup, those bottleneck holes. And this is what it looks like, kind of like a big heaping bowl of spaghetti on your plate. But we're able to process that and actually get timestamps and see how long that's taking.
What's the difference between the orange and the blue lines?
One's carts, one's walking.
Ah, okay.
Yeah.
Don't ask me to tell which was which. Okay.
I bet you the orange is carts.
Yeah.
We actually collect that data also. That doesn't come into play in this study, but further on, you'll hear Parker talk a little bit more about the use of these GPS loggers and another way that they analyze that data. So, going into pace of play at Rancho Park in 2015, this is going to be representing those 6-minute intervals. So you can see this is from 6 a.m. to 10 a.m. over a morning. And as the morning increases or progresses, those round times go up. And you can see at 10 a.m. they're as high as 6 hours. And that's only at 10. You can imagine at 2 p.m. how high those times could get up to. So what's the biggest problem with this is that golfers that should be spending about 5 hours at a course end up spending 6 or 7 hours at the course. And during the week, who has that much time? I wish I did, but we don't. So now, after the change was made to the tee time intervals, you can see the comparison of these round times. So the blue line is going to be the 8-minute starting intervals. And you can see that as the morning progresses, they don't increase at such a rapid pace as before. So you get to that 10 a.m. and you see that large gap. Now this gap represents, there you go. This gap represents almost an hour. So really what it's saying is that now, compared to back in 2015, golfers may save almost an hour out of their days just due to the change in starting intervals. Specifically, it could be attributed to the fact that there's no longer such a long wait on the first tee box, where back in 2015 and previous years, golfers would get to Rancho Park, they would book a tee time, say, for 8 a.m. They wouldn't tee off until about 8:45, sometimes 9 o'clock, which that's a lot of waiting around. Negatively impacts the golfer experience.
So you may see that the rounds increase during the day, which is between 6 and 8 minutes, which is, you may think, is what's the big difference? But the big difference was that before, the scheduled tee time or the published tee times were at 6 minutes. The actual tee time intervals at which they were teeing off was closer to 8 minutes. Mm-hmm. So there was actually no difference. So in actual tee starting interval between the stated 8 minutes and 6 minutes. So the reduction in wait that we're talking about all happens before you tee off. So let's say, use an example of a restaurant. You make a reservation at 7, you go there at 7 o'clock. Sorry, we're not going to be seated until 7:45. That was what's the point of taking a reservation at that point? So that was the experience at Rancho Park.
It's a heightened food rage right there.
Yes, we're big on food here at the USGA.
So we can take a further look at these wait times on the first tee box and see what actually changed from the previous years, from 2015 until now. On the left side, you have that 6-minute interval data, and you can see that as the morning progresses, those round times increase, and they get up to as high as about 36 minutes for just this group of golfers, and that's just over 3 days at Rancho Park.
Okay.
So now we collected the 8-minute interval data. You can see that there's little to no wait on the first tee anymore, which is good, and golfers are able to tee off closer to those booked tee times, so they're not standing around waiting. And this can drastically improve the golfer experience at Rancho Park. So.
Okay, sorry, we had a little time issue, so we were trying to move things along a little bit. I apologize for that. We actually have a couple of videos that we're not going to play, but it showed that golfers at Rancho Park did notice a difference between the 6-minute and 8-minute intervals and had positive things to say about it. I mean, that's not to say that Rancho and other courses don't have more to do. I mean, now they've gotten to a point where their actual tee time intervals match their published tee time intervals. They could probably go to 9 or 10 minute intervals. And to make the case for that, we're going to bring up Andy Tiger, who's a professor at Union University. Andy specializes in revenue models and he's developed actually a pace calculator deriving real data from ShotLink and other sources. And what Andy is going to show us is that people are willing to pay more for expedited or premium on better, faster service or faster experiences. Cases, an example, a lot of real life examples, express lanes. People are paying a toll to get access to HOV lanes. I think Ontario has just started this in the fall. They can, Bob is nodding his head at me, you can pay to get access to the HOV lanes. Airlines, you're paying to get access, earlier boarding, get in the front so you can get out and get to your destination faster. Amusement parks have fast pass, no waiting in line, and you just go along. So basically, the idea here is that time does equal money, and Andy's gonna show us how that can apply to the golf industry.
Well, thanks. Yeah, I throw math at supply chains, time-based systems, manufacturing systems, logistics systems, and in the industries that Unky just mentioned, people are willing to pay for reduced waiting. So if you combine that with queuing models or the ability to model how long people wait on golf courses, then you should be able to dial in an optimal tee time interval that doesn't just minimize waiting or maximize rounds played, but focus on maximizing revenue.
So set the stage, we want to cite a study that Global Golf Advisors, again, did a study for us 2 years ago about the value of improved pace of play, and these are some of the results that they discovered. Andy, we
want to say. Yeah, this is brilliant. This is awesome. The work that I'm doing is identifying bottlenecks, identifying queues. But this is very important. It shows that golfers are willing to pay for less waiting. And it looks like there's a 9% premium for a 15 to 30 minute reduction in waiting. And I think it's even different for
younger golfers.
Demographics.
Yep. Yeah, under 40, you pay up to 13%, where they're willing to pay 13% more. And when we talk about improved pace of play, we're talking about round times that are 15 to 30 minutes less than what they currently experience.
Okay. Next slide?
So next slide is, before we go ahead, we need to kind of, very smart man, a lot of engineering, a lot of technical stuff. So we need to set the stage with some definitions of some terminology that Andy's going to be using. So the first one is revenue management, scientific pricing. Andy, could you explain what that is?
Well, just scientific pricing, there's times when you just can't add capacity. If you're in the airline industry, to increase revenue, don't need additional planes. It's hard to build additional golf courses, but you still want to try to increase revenue. So you do that with the pricing strategy. The next one is
queuing theory.
Queuing theory is just all about understanding how things wait, how people wait, how parts wait in a system. It's a system where we have a lot of nonlinear relationships, and all that means is that things, incremental changes that you make, don't give linear results. They will be bad, and all of a sudden really good, or the other way around.
Finally, computer modeling. Well, yeah.
And this is just the concept that knowing where the bottleneck is today, or knowing what the things that you should change today, the result of that means that you're going to have another issue, another challenge. And the benefit of a computer model is that it allows you to plan things into the future. The other thing that computer models let you do is they let you be an out-of-the-box innovative thinker. This is a way for you to try different things, and most of them are very bad decisions. But you can try it freely, safely, cheaply in a computer model, and you'll see insight occasionally. You'll say, hey, that's a pretty cool idea. These very short tees, that's a really cool thing. You can try something and see what the benefit of that is. And that's what these computer models that we're using.
Could you explain the PACE model that you've developed?
Yeah, the PACE model, it's based on simulating people playing rounds of golf. And what we have to do is we have to quantify how long people are on tee boxes, how long they move through a fairway on the greens. And there's average times. Certainly we can come up with an average, but when there's variability attached to that, the case study that we did for what we're going to show is that we looked at a par 3 hole that on average takes 8 minutes, but the range of times to play it are anywhere from 7 to 12, and more importantly, most of the times are 7 minutes. The average is 8, but you'll get that occasional long time that is closer to 12 minutes. And a lot of time-based things, fixing a flat, working on repair, the times to do it are generally skewed to the right. They're generally not skewed to the left. You can't get any faster. The physics of something prevents you going to the left and shorter, but the things getting in the way create these things skewed to the right. And if you plan to an average, when you have systems that are that way, you're designing systems that aren't gonna do well.
Okay, so let's look at that case study that you talked about.
Yeah, the case study, again, it's actually fairly straightforward. It's an 18 hole, but they're all par three holes, so we know they're always waiting on tee boxes. We're not worrying about what is, and we ran a whole bunch of different changing the tee time intervals from 7 minutes to 15 minute tee times intervals. We can see that the rounds, this is waiting time, and the waiting time decreases as you increase the tee interval, and then what happens to rounds per day?
Good.
The rounds per day, if you look at the beginning, there's not really a drop in rounds per day when you go from a 7 to 8 minute tee time interval, and then it starts gradually going down. So the fact that these are nonlinear, they are related, but when do these things break over and start, it's different for each course. So you need to be able to model a specific course. But we're not trying to minimize waiting, we're not trying to maximize rounds played, we're trying to maximize revenue. And with the GGA study that shows that people are willing to pay for not waiting, are willing to pay for people behind you not to catch you and pressure you, and as soon as golfers know that and they're willing to pay, then you can actually start maximizing revenue. You can look and put a tee time interval that maximizes what people are willing to pay. And it's a great way to think. So for this particular case, it wasn't trying to maximize rounds played or minimizing wait time, it was maximizing revenue.
And that we find that at 9 minute intervals.
That's what this. This was busy days over an annual basis.
Right. So Andy's model has actually been used primarily for the highest levels of play. Took shot data and pace play data from ShotLink and other pro events, and used the model. And we are trying to take that same principle and move it over to recreational play. And obviously, the differences are that the recreational model, there's a lot more variabilities. With tour pros, you have very consistent shots, and people don't go here and there, and you have groups of three or groups of two. So this is a product that we're working on refining, and the more data that we can have, it will help to validate the model. And I think, Andy, you ran some of the model with some of the Rancho Park data and found that they're pretty close.
Yeah, that's going to be the ultimate goal. For these models to be useful, they got to be in your hands. They've got to be a point where you can use them. The math is probably pretty solid. The data is something where Lauren and Parker are collecting data to build more realistic models that we can start running these out.
Yeah, and pretty soon we hope to have a product that we put in your hands. You can put in customized to your course based on your course design, tee time intervals, anything else, some of the characteristics, and you'll be able to run these models yourself, so you have a better idea of where you can maximize the revenue. And it's not necessarily just about filling up the cheat sheet or whatever it is that you is important to you right now. So to build and to get some more data and to partly to help inform Andy's model, partly to answer some questions about, and not just questions, assumptions, anecdotal evidence that people have about pace of play. One of the ones that we have is what is the impact of green speed on pace of play? So a couple of years ago, we started a long-term research agreement at the University of Minnesota. Parker Anderson is a researcher there at the University of Minnesota, and he took over this project of trying to correlate green speed with pace of play, and he's gonna share with us what he did and how he went about finding some of this information.
Thanks, Hunky. And since we're talking about pace of play, I'll try to keep everything on time.
We're fine. You know what? As the organizer, I give you permission to go over a few minutes.
All right. First, I want to make a pitch for the benefits of research and for golf courses becoming golf laboratories. You know, we're talking about innovation this week, and without this data, building these data sets, we can't really innovate. And you know, hosting research projects at golf facilities will give a better understanding of how the systems function and how these flows function at your facility, and therefore promote better environmental, economic, and social productivity. You can see there's the S word made it up there, random. I apologize.
He didn't get the memo. He got it too late.
Yeah. So in turn, the golf benefits from this research partnership. So let's get to the data collection here, the study. So this study was designed to investigate the anecdote of fast greens result in slow play and build a database to help inform what is the true result there. The goal was to see how a change in green speed impacted pace of play in each data collection site, adjusted the green speeds from week to week over a 3-week period of 1-foot increments in stimp meter readings. So you can see We're measuring course conditions. We work closely with the course superintendent at each facility to take careful measurements of, as careful as possible, measurements of the course conditions and the green speeds.
So for each week, how many days did we collect data at each green speed?
So each week was a three-day three-day data collection.
Okay. So 9 days at each course.
Yep, and so we tried to adjust the green speed from in 1 foot increments from week to week.
Okay. Great.
Next slide, please, Anki. Yeah. So the next so not only were we collecting course condition data, we're collecting you know, a golfer arrives at the first tee, and we do a pre-round survey to collect demographic data on the golfer. We give them a GPS that Lauren mentioned earlier. You know, that they carry that GPS with them throughout their round. At the end, we collect the GPS device and then administer a post-round kind of player satisfaction survey. So this study was conducted over seven courses in the US. Two of these courses were private clubs. The rest were public. Data was collected on well over 2,000 golfers. And this gave us a database which gave us nearly 40,000 individual green times to look at. It's a large database. About 80%, a little over 80% were male of the participants, which is consistent with the National Golf Foundation numbers. 50% were over the age of 55. As far as juniors and millennials, only about 18% of the participants were in that category. And about 65% of golfers used golf carts, whereas the rest were walking in some form, whether it was carrying or using a push cart.
So what was the result?
So as far as the data analysis goes, we found green speed was a significant factor in impacting time spent on the green at all courses except Poppy Hills. The potential explanations for that could be they have a unique cart path only policy, but there's a number of factors and variables that we captured that had were shown to have an influence on green time, such as age, gender, player ability, and the mode of transportation. And so all of those influence play as well. So at the six courses, you know, that we're happy to have a large data set because that kind of got rid of some of the outliers of some of the influence of some of these areas. So you can see that in some cases, green times were a 1 foot increment change increased green time by 25 seconds per player per green, which is a huge influence. But again, there's many other factors involved.
So the reason we chuckled when you mentioned Poppy Hills is that Bruce redesigned Poppy Hills. So,
it's all his fault.
Yeah, it's all his fault. So asking you, when you redesign a course and when you design a course, how do you determine what the green speed is? How does that go about designing the green contour size and et cetera?
Well, yeah, we definitely need to know while we're in the design process, the goal of the owner. In this case, it was the Northern California Golf Association. They wanted to make sure there was at least seven hole locations and a hole location for every day. We tried to give them 10. Mm-hmm. And they came up with that they would like to have on a daily basis their average play and green speed would be between 9.5 and 10.
Okay.
And then for their tournaments, they would go no higher than 12.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the real determining factor is that go no higher than 12 gives you an idea of what kind of slope percentages you can accomplish in those hole locations. As you know, as us architects, we'll put slopes on all over the place that may not be hole locations in order to help feed shots and do all those good kind of things. But that's critically important. I think all the architects in the room would say, if I don't know how they're going to maintain these greens, I don't know how to design my green surfaces. Especially with the new grasses available today, man, you can get those greens really fast, quick, and have greens that become unplayable really quickly.
Andy, how does this sort of information help your pace modeling?
Well, the pace model becomes a business model when you start incorporating real data. You've got green speed issues, and you combine that with cart path only, and combine that with demographics, and you've got a model that you can make business decisions against.
Great. So finally, the conclusions.
Yeah, just some overall conclusions here. We found green speed impacts pace of play. You know, faster greens do result in slower paces of play. However, this influence may not be as strong as we originally considered. Another data point that we collected was in the post-round survey of asking golfers, how would you rate your overall playing experience? And we took those numbers and compared it to green speeds and found there was no significant relationship between player experience and the green speeds.
Great.
Good. Please publish that many times.
Yeah.
So we're kind of at the end of our little show, Dog and Pony Show. Are there any questions? I think we have time for a couple, right?
While people are doing questions, let me just do. At our golf course, we actually went from 8-minute times to 9-minute times and had a system to really enforce speed of play. At the time that we did that, we increased our rate from $48 to $54. Rounds went down about 1,000. Revenue went up significantly.
So real world example. Yep. Bob.
Okay. Getting into some of the topics before about tees and putting people on the right tees, there's a couple of questions that I'll try to summarize them. How do you deal with the sort of machoism of people who want to play certain tees or people who think they hit the ball a lot further than they do?
Okay, well, I may be the only golf course owner, I'm certainly the only one that I know, that actually threw people off the golf course, okay? If they wouldn't, you know, and the little sign that you saw earlier, it said if you, you know, are playing a set of tees that's too long for you, you know, we'll move you up. Guys who wouldn't move up, I literally, on the third time they were talked to, you're off the course. I'll call the pro shop, give your money back, but please don't ever come again.
One of the things about the longleaf system in Pinehurst is that they immediately hit you with this education. As soon as you get to the clubhouse, there's a graphic. As soon as you check in right next to the pro shop where you check in, there's a graphic. And then you go out to the practice range, there's another graphic saying, please play your tees, and here's how you calculate it.
Education, critically important.
Huge, huge.
Yep. One more question.
Someone else asked, how the variable tee distance, how does that affect the handicapping?
Ah, very, very good question. The key thing that, from what we understand, is that the golf course must be at least 33,000 and have
3,000 yards.
Yeah, 3,000
yards. So, wow,
that'd be a long one.
Again, the architect's making it more difficult, right? But the other thing is that there's got to be at least one hole 250 yards or greater as a four par.
So we're working with our handicapping team and. So you can get the tees re-rated, but there is a formula they can use from existing tees. It's basically a distant formula that you can use to get a temporary course rating and slope rating based on that. So, but you know, I think we'll talk a little bit more about tomorrow is that the handicap system is using a lot more data to make ratings, slope ratings, more adjustable based on conditions. So that may help you, help course owners, to take these tees and use that for handicapping purposes.
Right.
So, okay, great. Well, but thank you all for your time. I appreciate it. And I think Bob will come up to
thank you.
Take a break.
Nice job. Nice job.